Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this review of the Sanwa PC7000 multimeter. Now this is a 50/500,000 count multimeter. It can do PC data logging. It does have an external connection for the PC data logging. It does have a claimed DC accuracy of around 0.03/0.04% of its DC voltage range. Now, this end of the market does start to become interesting. I initially started trying to find challenges to the Fluke 87 when I was back in South Africa quite a while ago. And the first one I found there was the Breiman TBM867. And this, for its price in South Africa, was a lot cheaper than the Fluke 87. So the Fluke 87 is obviously generally known as the industry standard. But in South Africa, certainly it cost a lot of money. Here in the States on Amazon now, it's priced around $320 to $360, depending on where you buy it. The Fluke, however, has a lot of competition now, and that's why I just want to highlight this in this video as well. One of the main competition at the moment will actually now be the Amprobe AM160A, which I previously reviewed and is also one of my favorite meters on the bench. Also a 50/500,000 count, and again, as kindly pointed out by retired Caps, all these meters, so the Amprobe, the Sanwa, have the same IC, which is produced by Breiman. So these are all variants, but packaged a little differently. And for the first part of the review, what I'm going to do, I'm going to put the Fluke, the Amprobe, and the Sanwa side by side so we can actually compare them. Because now when you start to look at the features, packaging, and in particular the price, that could be a decider. Now when I talk about price, we're now getting to the point where I've almost got all the meters that I'm looking at getting in terms of doing a kind of shootout with the top level handheld multimeters. What's missing from the pack here at the moment, I would like to get hold of another Japanese meter, the Hioki, if I pronounced it correctly, and then a German meter, something like the Gossen. But in terms of pricing now, in terms of what we've got here, we've got the Agilent U1272A. So that's a 40,000 count with internal data logging. That goes for around $380. I've got the Isotec, which I still need to review. The IDM505, that also goes for around $380. It's a 100,000 count with internal data logging. We've got the Fluke, which is a 4,000 count, and in its high-res mode, it's a 20,000 count. That, as I said, goes for around $320 to $360. We obviously got the Amprobe 50/500,000 count, the Sanwa, but the Amprobe now is selling for $260 on Amazon Prime. So that at the moment, for the money, looks like a very good buy. The Sanwa costs $295. And at the moment, I don't know what the TBM actually costs, but these were always a little bit difficult to get hold of. But anyway, let's get stuck down onto the bench do a comparison. It's going to be a two-part video. We'll do all the kind of accuracy and general testing in the first part of the video. And in part two, we'll take the meter apart, have a look inside, do the mains testing, and then check the battery low warning level as well. Right, so this is the Sanwa. We'll have a closer physical look at it once we just see what comes packaged with it. In the box, it comes with a calibration assurance certificate. We'll obviously check the accuracy of the meter compared to its specs. It comes with a instruction manual, which has to be said is written in really nice English with nice illustrations. So a nice manual that does come with the device. It does come with a K-type thermocouple probe as well, which we'll test. And then it comes obviously with a set of leads. Now these leads do come with a nice protective cap on the front. It is removable. The test lead itself seems to be gold plated, so I hope obviously during the continuity test it'll make nice contact. It says rated for Cat 2 1000 volts on there. It's branded as Sanwa. It is rubberized, so it really has got a nice feel in the hand. It's got a nice bit of strain relief at the end. The actual leads themselves aren't silicone, but they do have a nice quality feel for them. And they certainly seem to be, they're rated, it says here, for 2000 volts. 18 AWG is the actual grade of the wire. So a nice set of leads. If we go down to the actual banana plug itself, also nice rubberized round here where this the actual insertion piece is plastic, and again nice strain relief. So certainly no complaints about the quality of the leads. The actual meter itself, when you get it out the box and get it into your hands, you realize straight away it does have a nice feel. Certainly no complaints with the quality of the plastics at all. A nice easy to use selector switch, nice rubberized buttons for selecting the various functions. The display is has got a nice clear LCD. It does have a slight curve to that. You'll see that it does pick up a little bit of reflection. As I say, probably for me, my opinion, the flat lens in the front of a display is my preference because they are far less prone to picking up reflection. It does have this gray holster surrounding the actual unit itself. It does have this kickstand. It's one of these ones where you have to get your finger under the back here, and I always find these sometimes a little bit fiddly to get open. But nonetheless, it's on there. Nice and stable, and of course easy to use with one hand. At the back, it has this built-in, it comes with this magnetic hanger, which is really handy. Not many meters actually come with a built-in hanger, and what they've done, they've made it so it actually fits into the data logging port, so it is kept out of your way, so it just goes in, clips in there, and it's out of the way but is ready for use. So this data logging port, I don't have the actual interface to test the actual software, but this will be very similar to the Breiman software and the AmProbe. If we have a look at the fittings on the other meters, very much the same. So we can certainly see the similarities between these meters and that they obviously have the same heritage. Before I actually put the original Breiman away, what I wanted to do is actually just bring you in closer for a quick closer view of them. And we'll see if we have a look at the functionality and the layouts of the functions on the dials, very similar between the two of them. And just before we turn it on, I've just pulled it out of its holster. Again, a nice holster which certainly adds a nice level of protection to the outside of the meter. It's one of those meters which certainly doesn't look bad when it's outside of its holster. If you're using it on your bench and wanted it to look a little less bulky, then certainly nothing wrong with having it outside of the holster as well. As a quick overview to kind of its features and functionality, first off, it's rated for Cat 2 1000 volts, Cat 3 600 volts. The milliamp range is fused for half an amp, which is nice. The main 10 amp range is obviously fused for 10 amp. It is true RMS. It's got a low pass filter for AC and obviously measures frequency. It does logarithmic measurements, and you can have a logarithmic measurement in reference to multiple impedance levels. Now this is something I've not gone into on multimeters before, so that's something I plan to do a separate video on. It then does voltage, frequency obviously. You can also measure a DC or AC voltage with a DC or AC component as well. Something else I will do a separate video on. Millivolts AC, resistance, and Siemens, nano Siemens, so that's the inverse of resistance, and you can potentially measure very high resistance levels with that. Temperature, capacitance, diode test. It even has a test for process control networks, and then obviously your microamp range. It does do this record button, does the min-max average. The capture does crest measurements. You've obviously got your hold, your select button for your secondary functions. You've got a range hold. You've got a relative button, which if it's held down will take it into its higher resolution 500,000 count mode. Right, so for the first part of the testing, what I'm going to do, I'm going to include the Fluke and the AmProbe. We just want to do a comparison now when I switch them on in terms of the speed and the resolution that they measure at. What I want you to note again, while I've got them switched off, the Fluke and the AmProbe have the flat lens in front of the LCD, whereas the Sanwa has a slightly curved lens, and as you can see, that's more prone to picking up reflections from a wider range, where it's far easier to get a viewpoint of these without any reflections. Right, so the first thing perhaps to observe as I got them switched on is the actual size of the LCD digits themselves. The Sanwa has a kind of finer, thinner digit, which initially didn't take my fancy, but after using it side by side with the other meters, I actually quite like the actual digits that they use. It seems a little grayer, just note the background, that might have to do with the actual angle that the meter is sitting at in comparison to the others, so it's certainly not that dark. If you're looking at the right angle, the contrast gray level is similar to the other meters. I'm going to switch the output on, And the first thing we want to note is just to have a look at the update speeds. Now the Fluke, I think, goes around 4 updates per second. Both of these should be doing, in their low res mode, doing about 5 updates per second. So certainly between them, even though the Fluke is a little bit slower, I'm quite happy with the update speed of the Fluke. But I must say, both the, obviously the Sanwar and the Anprobe update at a very nice speed. And all of these, for a change, I've got 3 meters down here where the actual bar speed of the bar graph on all of these is at a really nice speed. So on these two, it's noted as 60 times per second, which is what you want if you want a nice analog representation. Things to note, in particular, let's say on the Anprobe, as I noted in the previous review, is that that bar graph tends to be hidden because it's right at the bottom of the frame. The Sanwar has it nicely prominent and growing bigger, so it's nice and easy to see, and I've got no complaints of the view of the Fluke bar graph. The next thing I want to check and show is perhaps when they auto range. You can see the speed at which the other two, they go fairly quickly. Here is where the Fluke drops down into a lower resolution mode, whereas you've still got the 3 digits on the other 2 meters. If we go up to, let's say, 20 volts, so let's just go up, we obviously still have the nice resolution down to 3 digits on the other 2 meters, all the way up to the limit of my power supply. But the high res mode is quite interesting because when we take it into the high res mode, on the other meters, we straight away get an extra digit. On the Fluke, you'll notice it's in the high res mode, but we don't get the extra digit. It's only when we go down to 2 volts, or just below 2 volts, and if we go back up towards 2 volts, then we get our 4 digits. Obviously the others have got 5 digits, they've got the default higher resolution. But the Fluke is a bit odd in that it doesn't just add an additional digit as the other ones do. So you're only gonna kinda get that high res mode, that really high res mode down below 2 volts. And then it'll maintain those 3 digits up to 20 volts. And then it drops down to 2 again. So that's just something to note, and obviously on these you've still got your 4 digits, which again, if you're playing with electronics, let's say you're charging batteries or playing with solar panels, having that level of resolution can be really handy. One other thing to note, even though the spec sheet claims that these are supposed to slow down to, I think, 1.25 times per second in their high res mode, to me, to the eye, they're still going almost as fast, at least doing at least 4 or 5 updates per second, even in the high resolution mode. Whereas the Fluke perhaps now seems to be a little more jerky. The last test I'm going to do with these together is just to see if there's any overshoot. So just note the voltage on all of them. As I said, when I do this with my eye through the camera, it can be difficult to judge. So if I switch them off and power them on, all of them, thankfully, don't display a value until they have the final value, which is nice to see. So there's no overshoot, they wait and they display the actual value. So certainly no issue with overshoot on any of them. Right, we'll just have a quick check at the accuracy. I've obviously got the voltage standard here. 0.2499 is what it should be, and it's spot on that. 1.5 volts to 3 places. It is a smidgen out at the end, but certainly within its specification. At 5 volts, it could be, if I took the last digit away to take it out of its high res mode, it could be down to 5.0025. So it's still within spec, but certainly creeping up towards that 0.03 or 0.04% accuracy. On the 7.7500, again, we're a few counts out there, but it will be in spec for the level that it's at. Right, and on the 9.95 range, because this now falls into the higher range, the accuracy quote now for this is 0.05%. So it just falls within that, but it's right borderline in terms of being within that. The 0.05% is the same as the Fluke. Right, so now we're on to the DMM Check Plus. And here again, just on the 5 volt setting, certainly within its spec, that's on the DC setting. We're going to go to AC. and there the reading should read 4.999. So I just want to let it settle. So it is obviously doing RMS, and it is slightly out, but certainly within the spec for AC, it will be within spec. If you use the select button here, you can obviously go between your logarithmic display, and you can also then bring down your frequency display to the main display. So you get more resolution, and then you've got your AC voltage reading in the top display over here. Later on, we will check it does have another frequency range for logic signals. So that we'll have a look at with the signal generator. The next thing we're going to have a look at is current measurement. I'm leaving the meter in the voltage setting. What I want to see is if it does warn us or bleat when I change the leads. It does, which is good. We go over to milliamps. At the moment, I'm still in the AC setting, so I'll just switch this over to DC. And we should be reading 1.001. And it is certainly close enough. No complaint there. The top reading is obviously related to process control network, so that's being showed in the secondary display. If we go to an AC setting, right, so I just went away to double check the actual accuracy for the milliamp range on AC, because this seems rather low. It should be reading 1.001, and this is a few counts below that, but it's 1% on this range. So that is just within that range. So it's very close to the kind of accuracy figures. Then in terms of the input resistance for the main 10 amp range, out of interest, that is quoted as 0.01 ohm. So nice and low for the main 10 amp range. The milliamp range is quoted as 1 ohm, which is lower than some other multimeters. And then the microamp range is rated as 100 ohm, which is much the same as other meters. So what we'll do next, we'll have a look at the actual burden voltage across those ranges. So out of interest, on the milliamp scale with 1 milliamp, we've got 1.66 millivolt drop. So that's 1.66 millivolt per milliamp, which is a little better than the Fluke, but nonetheless, we obviously need to realize the issues with the resistance across the shunt resistor and the multimeter. We now go to the microamp range, and it's measuring obviously spot on 1 milliamp on the microamp range, but obviously that steps up. And again, this is the same for most meters. It's certainly not bad, but in the same bracket as most multimeters. So it's reading 101.7 millivolt on the microamp range for that 1 milliamp of current. Right, next we're going to measure resistance. So I'll just check the leads. We can also check the auto ranging. It's not too bad. Just try that again. Okay, so we've got something in the leads, and obviously this does have a delta out feature. So if I relative or delta out that, we're at zero, and we'll start doing the measurements. Right, and for the 100 ohm resistor, which should be reading 100.05, it was there initially, it's coming down a little bit, but certainly that would be within its spec. The 1K is noted as being 1.0004, so certainly within a ball hair, or a little, drifting off a little bit, but still very close to the actual value. The 10K is noted as being 10.001. We're a little bit under that, a few counts, but no problem. Just something to note, that here, when you're measuring resistance, you don't get your extra resolution. That's on the DC voltage side. The 100K is noted as being 100.1. So again, splitting a little bit of difference with the last digit over there, not far off that. Right, so next I'm going to test the capacitance. And I must say, looking at the spec and doing a little bit of testing, it seems to have a reasonable range with the capacitance. I will note I've got these leads on here. So I'm going to delta out what's on the display right now. And I'm going to start right down the bottom end of the where the picofarads are, so 300 pico. And if we just let it settle, certainly within the error of what's going on with the leads and everything else and the meter and the decade box, this is doing very well. Many meters that I've tested won't go and measure down to this range. So just check two, yeah. 100. Yeah, it still manages to measure it. So certainly once we get up to the higher ranges, no issue with measuring those. 4 micro. And again, for the kind of tolerance, can't really complain. Let's go to 10 micro. So on those smaller values, certainly no complaints. So next, let's throw something challenging at it. I've got a 3,300 microfarad, right? So I'll just connect up the big fella, the 3,300 micro. Now, many meters that I test do struggle with this one. And we'll just let it settle. But wow, so if we leave it, it is almost spot on. So for one, great that it can do it. It's getting a very good reading. And it's obviously reading is 3.3 microfarad, which is correct. And this is rated to up to 25 microfarad, which as far as I can recall is one of the highest capacity levels that I know a meter can do. I stand to be corrected, but certainly no issue there. Right, so next we'll test the diode test on a kind of standard diode. So no problem with showing the kind of 4.8 drop across that diode. Going to a red LED, it illuminates and it's able to show the drop across that, the 1.68 volts. I go to the blue, it's managing to illuminate it, but it's not managing to throw the drop. So let's just see what voltage it is able to use. So there we go, the voltage that it's using is 2.9 volts and in the manual it says just under 3 volts. So it's according to spec. Right, and as noted, it does come with a K-type probe. This time I do have the polarity correct, so it won't seem as if I'm dead. The current temperature in my lab, and that's verified by two other thermometers, says 22.3. Might be slightly different at the bench, but certainly within the realms of that. If I just hold on to it, fairly nice quick update speed on the display. So no issue there. If we push the select button, we get Fahrenheit. Right, the next thing we're going to check is the continuity tester with its leads. It's got obviously the gold-plated tips. So it sounds as though it's latched, but it could just be that the leads are very good quality. No, there's a bit of scratchiness there. It's not latched, but because the leads are that good quality, it sounds very good. And it's very fast, so no issue there. Right, so next a quick check on the frequency. Now here I've got it on its logic frequency measurement and I've got a 2.5 volt peak to peak signal going into it. It is quoted as going up to 2 megahertz. So I'm not gonna mess around too much. We'll check the bottom of the range and the top of the range. So I've got my frequency generator set to 10 hertz at the moment and certainly just a ball hair off that. We'll go down to some to 1 hertz. Let's just see how well it does there. Just about able to pick up the 1 hertz. If I go to 3, no problem there. I'm going to take it up to, let's say, 20 hertz. And it's just off, and because it goes to 3 places, I'm going to play with the last digit. I'm going to go up 1 on 2, in fact, on the generator. And it is centered enough that it's actually picking up the last digit as I change it. So certainly nothing wrong with the actual resolution that it's measuring to. It's slightly out. I've got down to, I say 6, it's just about to pick that up. Perhaps it's settling in. So it's only 1 count out from my frequency generator. Okay, let's go to the top end. Okay, I've put in 1 kilohertz. And as we can see, it is showing that, barring a little bit of a flicker. I'm going to go to 1 megahertz. No problem there. Take it up to 2, no problem. 2.1, let's see where it falls over. Okay, so 2.7, once if I come back and go back up to about there, 2.6, 2.7, as soon as I go to 2.8, it falls over. That's certainly well over spec. And just while I've got it there, I'm gonna bring it back down to 2 and go down to the 4th digit. I've got 2003, and it's certainly very close to that. So certainly no issue with the frequency counter on a logic wave. Right, before we test one of the last things, before we get to part two, we're gonna check min-max average. It does have a backlight. So if I, let's just see if I put that on, you can see it come on, I'll put the lights off. So there we go, nice evenly lit up. From the camera is doing a slightly better job. There are some hot spots on the side here, but certainly no issue. It lights up very nicely. Right, so we're gonna check the min-max average. I've purposefully just got it below 5 volts before it auto ranges because I wanna see if the auto range works in min-max average. So I push the record button. Saying min-max, let's just dial things down as we push it. So that's showing us the max value, the minimum value, which is now counting, average, and it's an average over time, which I like. And then we get to our real-time reading, and now we're gonna go over the 4 volts. And, oh, yes, it does. It auto-ranges in min-max average. Okay, so that's a nice feature to have. So certainly no complaints with that at all. Obviously, in this mode, you just keep on cycling through by pushing the button itself to see the min-max average or your real-time reading, and then hold it down for a couple of seconds to bring you out to your normal state. So that's the end of part one. In part two, we'll obviously take a look inside, do the mains measurements, and then also see the battery level warning.